So the topics that I would be covering would be a little introduction to the Indian education system, some aspects and components of e-learning, some examples of online gaming and e-assessments, and basically the rationale behind using games in education. Let's picture this. India has over 230 million students and only 6 million teachers. That means a ratio of one teacher versus 38 students, whereas the A global education system says a basic ratio should stay around one teacher versus five students. So you can imagine what's happening, teachers versus students. We have around 350 universities because a latest news came in where 44 deemed universities were deregistered, and we have only 18,000 colleges all over India. The gross enrollment from primary education to higher education drastically drops from 108% to a mere 10%. The reasons could be many, but the main reasons are boredom, accessibility, and lack of motivation. So how do you learn? So what keeps you motivated to learn? I have a five-year-old son, and I ask my son, you know, what keeps you want to learn more? And he answered in such a simple way, and he said, I learn when I think, when I do, when I watch and listen, and above all, when it's fun. I enjoy when I'm learning. So that was the crux. And if we see, most of us, we learn when we do, when we see, and when we hear. That's a small bar graph of, I had taken a small sample size of my own class asking who learns better in which way. Some of them answered that I learn when I do. Some of them said when I see, and some of them said when I hear. But basically, if you look at all of us, we are actually a combination of all three. So we are a combination of all three, and so is e-learning. E-learning is a tool where you can use the combination of all three. That is, you're doing, you're hearing, and you're seeing. I'm not getting into the definition of e-learning. I think most of you must be knowing that. An effective e-learning model would be where your participants, that means your learners or students, are open to new learnings, new ways of learnings, and to some extent the learning environment that a tutor is making is matching to their cultural environments. It's very important for a tutor to know what cultural background the student is coming from, and is he or she PC efficient or not. Is there any anxiety to work on online? That could also lead to many problems. Design activities in e-learning could be in multiple formats, which could be scenarios and simulations, polls and surveys, games and puzzles, journals, blogs and wikis, and discussion forums and debates. E-learning can be delivered through audio videotapes, CD-ROMs, internet, email, chat, audio video conferencing, and satellite television. E-learning can also be instructed in a distributed classrooms. That means, let's say I'm relaying a game and I'm sitting in one room, but the game is being relayed in different classrooms, and each student in different classrooms is playing that the same game. It's like a competition between, let's say, sections within the school, or it could be within a single classroom or a combination of both. The best way of applying an instruction would be where the teacher is, or the tutor is, in control. And the tutor can be in control in two manners. That could be teacher as a guide and teacher as a referee. Teacher as a guide is controlling the game in terms of he or she is taking the students through different scenarios and making them go ahead step by step. Whereas a teacher as a referee is dividing the class into teams and is setting tasks for them, maybe role-playing tasks, where the teams are competing against each other and they're coming up with a solution. Now, the good thing here is that no matter which team is coming up with a solution, whoever wins, the other part of the team also is learning from the process. The whole aspect of e-learning is learning through the process and not through the content. Thus, to have a systematic approach to designing a game or a a role-playing situation. What a tutor needs to focus is on is sources, design, delivery, interaction, and learning environment. So when I say sources, by sources I mean what kind of philosophies of learning you're trying to follow. Like these days, globally, constructivism is considered the best policy or the best philosophy for learning. And by sources, I also mean who are your students, knowing who are your students, what backgrounds they are coming from, and also knowing what was their work progress. Especially in Indian education system, there is a problem in, especially in schooling. Let's say a group of students have passed from class 5th to class 6th. Now the teachers teaching in class 6th are not bothered what happened to them in class 5th. All they are bothered about is finishing the curriculum, and that's it. To some extent, yes, they do get a feedback from the previous class that so-and-so student, maybe A and B student, needs a little help, and D and E student are excellent. But what about the other students? The tutor has to be absolutely impartial to all the students and not bothered only about the highermost and the lowermost. So this is where your philosophies and sources come in. Instructional design. When I say design, I don't mean what colors they are. I don't mean what kind of characters you're putting in. But by design, I mean what kind of process you're trying to follow. What kind of learning objectives you're trying to target. So the process in terms of design is important and not really the content. Also, for knowing the best instructional design, we need to work on that what are the goals and objectives that we are setting for the learners, what kind of learning we are trying to target, also the tool that we have designed, what are the strengths and weaknesses of these tools, and is there a scope of revision? And if there is a scope of revision, then it has to be done within that time period, or you can call it a semester or an academic year, and not let just pass them over and maybe I'll try it later. It has to be done then and there. Delivery methods would be best where you are using mixed medias. That means I am using to some extent the technology, the latest technology, and of course traditional teaching, which was through a whiteboard and black marker, traditional lectures, some games, maybe a PowerPoint presentation, but it has to be a mix of medias. In the morning, I had attended a session where, and also I've learned about it, where they say no matter what age group, the attention span of a student is just 15 minutes. So if you're going on a lecture for more than 15 minutes, the student will lose their attention. So you have to keep changing the activity. Shift from lecturing to PowerPoint, PowerPoint to maybe a 15 minutes game, come back to lecturing, but that's how it has to be. It has to be a mix of medias. More the interactions, better the learning. And the interactions, especially if you're using any technology, e-learning technology, could be a learner to instructor. I could, as a participant, as a learner, I could have doubts, I could ask my instructor. Learner to learner, I'm collaborating with my peer groups and learning from each other. Learner to content, the content which is there, I'm trying to assimilate it, analyze it, evaluate it, and go further. And learner to technology, I'm getting inspired by what's happening around me. It could be a virtual simulation, it could be simple animation, but I am interpreting it, analyzing it, and maybe somehow anticipating the next step. Learning environments, especially e-learning environments, can be set at home, can be set on remote, can be set at computer labs, or maybe a mixture of all. So putting e-learning together, they say that e-learning brings out the five I's of learning, which is interaction, introspection, innovation, integration, and information. And these are, I think, it says it all. All these five I's say all about education as such. What we are really looking from our student these days. So what we have to remember is that e-learning is an experiential learning. It will make you do and then reflect on what you have done, and it will make you do again and reflect back on it again. until and unless you have it right. So it's a cycle, you could call it a spiral cycle. It's happening again and again till the time you know that you've hit the nail. Now I come to my paper. My focus of my paper was teaching through online games and assessments, games for 5 to 10 year olds and assessment from 12 to 19 years old. And we'll go further on this. Now 50% teachers globally all around have considered using games in their classrooms. And when I say games, I don't mean only online games, but any kind of games. And almost one third of the teachers have used online games in their classrooms. Why do you think they have learned? Why do you think they have used these? Because, firstly, games are extremely challenging for the students. And games are difficult. The difficult it is, more motivated they feel to solve it. So it's of course bringing in motivation. And as it says, games are fun. So it's enjoyment, it's motivation, it's challenging, it's difficult. So I'm enjoying it all through. Impact of online gaming on education could be that somehow it's developing and enhancing your visual perceptual skills. Because let's say I'm looking at a screen of a game, and I don't know how many of you must have played this game. People of my generation is known as the X generation, which is around from 25 to 45 years old right now. They must have started playing a tennis game in which there's a full black screen and there are just two bars on the side which is hitting the balls. Long time back it used to be known as tennis game. Then came a game in which there was just one view of a full tennis player, a virtual view of a tennis player, where you could control the speed of the ball. And now a game has come where you can see both the players, where you can control your speed and direction of the ball, and you can anticipate by what speed and from which direction the other player is hitting back the ball. So that's how you are enhancing your visual perceptual skills. It leads to also learning some outcomes and objectives in an easy manner. Also, many times what happens is that some of the learning objectives you might not have set, but eventually the students tend to learn something different out of that target that you have set for them. So pedagogy and games go hand in hand because, as I said earlier, that games are extremely motivating. They're social experiences. Students are collaborating among themselves. They're going back to tutors, and not just the tutor who has set the task, but to many other tutors, and maybe going to the library to read some more. So they are collaborating. And of course, as I said, constructivism is the latest philosophy on education. They're going through that through experimentation. So let us look at technology across generations. As I said, I am from the X generation, and the students are from the Y generation. Students right now are from the Y generation. So who are the Y generation students? They are in the age group of 5 to 25 year old. They were born wired, that's what they say. Highly, highly motivated. You ask any student these days to type an SMS on the phone, I think they can type in around 10 characters per second or per 2 seconds, whereas ask the X generation, they're still fiddling up with their SMSs. Twitch speed also, the Y generation do not consider work as work. They think work is play. And that is why they enjoy their work also. But if we look at this graph, we'll see that most of the hits online are by the Y generation. And as the age is going up, higher is the bar going. There have been many cognitive changes in the Y generation as compared to X generation, which are, of course, as I said earlier, twitch speeds versus conventional speed, random access, graphical first rather than text first. They want to be connected, they're active, play is work for them. They want instant feedbacks rather than patience, that they'll wait for the tutor to give the feedback. Fantasy, they live in a fantasy world. I don't know how many of you have heard of the Second Life. Has anybody heard of the second life?
Yeah.
So many of these Y generation students are logged into the second life, which is more like a second life is an online tool, which is like a virtual life. You can go there. You can go there as an avatar. I'm sure you must have seen the Avatar movie. How many of you seen the Avatar movie? Okay, quite a few. So in Avatar, this guy is portraying as someone else and is going in a different world. Similarly, in Second Life, you can portray as somebody else. You can have a totally different outlook. You could be just somebody else in your profession and you're living a life on Second Life. And they consider technology as their friend and not as their foe. So the generation next, or the next generation, what are the expectations from education? They are looking for 24/7 access. They want IT integration. They think education as a commodity. When I say education as a commodity, that is, they're looking education as a ladder to success and not education as for imbibing knowledge, okay? Not to create themselves. How to put it? I would say the Generation X, I from the Generation X, took education because it created my own personality, whereas Generation Y is interested in education to reach a step and not take education as it is. And of course, they want value-added courses and experiences in their education. And that's why a lot of vocational courses have come up these days, rather than the original, just the doctor, engineer, or maybe the architect. These days, there are many, many lines. So who is playing? Almost everyone is playing. There's no age gap. Everybody's playing. And what are they playing? Everything. Everything and anything on this world, they're playing everything. So the games can be categorized as action games, adventure games, fighting games, puzzle games, role-playing simulations, or sports games. And believe me, all of these games can be incorporated in any curriculum or in any subject content. You might say, how would you include a sports game in fashion? I come from a fashion college. So each of these games can be incorporated in any subject, and what matters is how you're designing it, what are the learning styles that you're targeting, what is the learning cycle, and how user-friendly it is. These are some children games for schools, which can be incorporated as it is. And there's some more sites for again 5 to 10 year olds. We are also looking for multitasking skills in our students, especially for higher education. Basically looking for e-assessments in higher education. These are some of the examples for e-assessments, which is wikis, blogs, surveys. You can have Why Not Assess, which is you can just put your questions in and your question paper is made right away. These are some downloadable educational games for higher education. Softwares to create your own games according to your subject curriculum. Lastly, I would like to say that we are also trying to inculcate some independent study in our students. And for this purpose, a group of IIT colleges here in India have come up with open access resources, which are the NPTEL, Eklavyan, E-Grid, where any student, not just a student, but anybody can access high quality of books, literature, anything related to your content. So my point is here that if games are so good, why is not everybody using it? Well, there are some people who believe that games can lead to violence. It brings aggression in child. It can lead to addiction. Games do not have any relevance to education. Many people still believe that. But I don't think so. These ideas should stop us from using games in education, because similar points, motivation, challenging and all. Lastly, that I would like to say is that India is in the top 6 countries of the world to adopt e-learning in various industries, and education being one. Also, India ranks 3rd in e-learning resources, cost advantage, scalability, maturity, and overall performance. These are some of the pioneer companies, organizations which are using e-learning games for educational purpose. Thank you.